So let's continue our discussion of competitive inhibition by talking about the statins. By the way, there's a link underneath this YouTube video that should give you access to the slides if you care to take notes. So the statins. Well, the statins are probably the most commonly prescribed drug in the United States, and their job is to lower the levels of lipids. They are lipid-lowering drugs. Lipid-lowering drugs. They decrease your cholesterol. And every year, about 250 million prescriptions are written. So you got to know the statins. And the first thing you should know is, how would you recognize one of these statin drugs by name? So how would you do it? Well, the answer to that is any drug that ends with the suffix statin is obviously a statin drug. And so examples here are atorvastatin, or rosuvastatin. And because these statins are the most commonly prescribed drugs in the United States, they are the ideal candidate to discuss drug interactions. And the reason we have these drug interactions, and we somewhat discussed this in the last video, which I'd recommend taking a quick peek at if you're confused, but the reason we have these drug interactions is because the statins are predominantly metabolized by the cytochrome P450 34A. So I'm going to write statins. They are metabolized by CYP3A4, which is an enzyme, the name of it. And that forms the inactive metabolite. Remember, 3 was the name of the family, A was the name of the subfamily, 4 was the actual name of the enzyme. And this, as we remember, this enzyme is the most common enzyme that metabolizes drugs in our body. And so the reason we have these drug interactions is because things like grapefruit juice, antacid medications, and the macrolides, they inhibit this enzyme. And by inhibiting that enzyme, they are going to increase the amount of statins in our body. And so these three examples are three examples that every clinician, I feel, should know. But, you know, I could have listed 30 examples. And it's really any drug that inhibits this enzyme will cause or has the potential to cause an increase in the statin concentration and possibly side effects. So the first example we're going to talk about is grapefruit juice. And you will find a grapefruit juice warning on most bottles of prescription statin medications. Now, let me just say that one glass of grapefruit juice in the morning isn't going to kill you. But several glasses, especially at night, when most people are taking their statins, this actually might affect drug metabolism. And so you're bound to have a parent or family member ask you why grapefruit juice isn't allowed, and what, you know, the point here is that you should be able to answer them. So what would your answer be? Well, underneath here I wrote that CYP3A4 is inhibited by something called furanocoumarins. So if I was going to respond to your parent or to my parent or family member, I would say there is something in grapefruit juice called furanocoumarins. And the furanocoumarins prevent the statins, the drugs that you're taking, from being metabolized in your body. And if I wanted to provide more details, I would say, and so these statins, if you take them with grapefruit juice and you take, let's say, more than one glass of grapefruit juice, especially at night, these furanocoumarins are going to inhibit that super important metabolizing enzyme in your body called CYP3A4, and as a result, the concentration of statins might build up. So because CYP3A4 is inhibited by the furanocoumarins in grapefruit juice, this might lead to an increase in our statin blood concentration. Okay? And that's the gist of it. That's how competitive inhibition is working, and that's why we're getting these drug interactions. So the next example that I've listed here are the antacid medications. Now, it's not all antacids. Here, I'm specifically talking about the H2 blockers. So So we should remember that the H2 blockers, and if you haven't learned it yet, here's a great opportunity to learn, they decrease acid secretion in the body by blocking a histamine receptor. And it's not the H1 receptor that we saw in a previous video, which is for an anti-allergy medication, it's the H2 receptor. So this is actually a great opportunity to integrate a little bit. So let's draw a little picture here on the right, and let's cover the parietal cell and how this works. So remember that the parietal cell is in the stomach, and one side of it, the luminal side, has a proton pump. And that's what I've drawn right here in orange on the left-hand side. And so what this proton pump does is it takes protons, as its name implies, and it pumps them out into the stomach and helps create hydrochloric acid. And it does that by replacing that proton with a potassium. And remember that this uses ATP. But we're not interested in this part as of right now. What we're interested on is on the other side where we have these receptors. And so there are three receptors that you hopefully learned about in physiology. So I'm just going to draw three receptors. One, two, and let's make this one kind of curved. So these three receptors, by the way, this is the parietal cell. Let's label that. Parietal cell. So my question to you is, if you remember physiology here, what are the three molecules that can bind to their receptors on the parietal cell and increase acid secretion? And hopefully you're saying those three molecules. One of them we just talked about is histamine. So that's what I'm going to draw in blue here as a triangle. The other is kind of neurally controlled. I believe it's through the vagus nerve. That's acetylcholine. So let's just write here histamine. This other one is acetylcholine. And the last one's kind of tricky. This last one here is actually gastrin. You might remember gastrin if you learned about it in physiology, possibly pathology, where some patients have a gastrin-secreting tumor in the pancreas. And so because we are secreting gastrin, that activates this parietal cell to release lots of protons, and the person as a result gets tons of stomach ulcers or duodenal ulcers. And that was called a gastrinoma. And we saw that with something called Zollinger-Ellison syndrome. Just a quick little integrative fact here. But getting back to this histamine receptor, this is the H2 receptor, and we have the drug. And so that drug essentially blocks histamine from having its effect on the parietal cell, and those are the H2 blockers. Now you want to know at least one of the names of these H2 blockers. And one of those names is cimetidine. Cimetidine. So going back to this image on the left here, cimetidine, one of the things it does is acts as an antacid. And by blocking that H2 receptor, or having an opposite effect of histamine. But the other thing that it does is it also inhibits the cytochrome P450 3A4 that we talked about. And again, as a result, we're going to get an increase in that statin concentration. Same story. Now there's actually another drug here that is not just called cimetidine that you might be more familiar with, and that's an over-the-counter medication. Actually, cimetidine is over-the-counter too. If you want a little historical fact, cimetidine was one of the first blockbuster drugs. That is a drug that generates over $1 billion of annual revenue. But many people haven't heard of cimetidine. They might have heard of something called Zantac. Zantac. And Zantac is a brother of cimetidine. It's just another drug called ranitidine. So let's move on to the last example, and that is the statin drugs with macrolide antibiotics. Really quick, what are two statins that we covered? Atorvastatin, rosuvastatin. Very nice. So the macrolide antibiotics. Well, you'll learn here shortly when we cover antibiotics that the macrolides, what they're typically known for, is not their only use, but they're known for upper respiratory tract infections. And because they're antibiotics, these are bacterial upper respiratory tract infections. And I'm just going to write URI. And the way that you would recognize these drugs is that the macrolides, they all end with the word mycin, M-Y-C-I-N. And so we'll see a couple of examples. And the way I remember all the macrolides is with this little term here, MACE. The macrolides, the M, are azithromycin, clarithromycin, and erythromycin. Notice that we have this mycin at the end of it. We also have a throw here as well, but the way I remember it is all the mycins. So I actually had an attending recently ask me a question, which I want to share with you. And that question was, which macrolide antibiotics is it okay to give to patients who are taking the statins? And while you probably won't get that exact question on a board exam, it's important clinically, and you know, you might get it on a future board when you're past basic pharmacology. And the answer to that question really depends on, out of these three macrolide antibiotics, one of them does not inhibit cytochrome P450-3A4. And that one is the one I'm kind of pointing to right now, that is azithromycin. So azithromycin, let's just write here, this one has no CYP3A4 inhibition. But the other ones, clarithromycin and erythromycin, do. So real quick, I just gave you three examples. You know, grapefruit juice, more than one glass, antacid medication, specifically the H2 blockers, and the macrolide antibiotics with the exception of azithromycin.